Hello from my side. So start the timer. Okay. So as already introduced, I'm talking about building secure cloud native applications with Spring Boot and Spring Security. So first question would be, how many of you have implemented an application with Spring or Spring Boot, Spring Security? Oh, a few. And how many of you are familiar with the term of cloud native? So it's good that I have some description inside. So about me, I am mainly not a security guy, but I spent last year on the AppSecEU at Amsterdam. And so I was very impressed on that great community doing the security stuff. So I had the idea to have a session from the developer view, so from the builder view, actually. And that's because I'm here today. So most of the time, I'm dealing with stuff like being agile, implementing Java IE or Spring, doing some single sign-on stuff with Summer, OAuth2, also being in the cloud, a bit of threat modeling, but only a few, and a lot of DevOps stuff, IoT now, so many things. And I'm also supporting OWASP as a member since last year. You can reach me by Twitter on Agile Security, for example, or by email. And I work for Novatech Consulting Company that is located in Stuttgart in Germany. So I apologize for my English. I'm not a native speaker. So to begin with, what I noticed in my project history of about 20 years until now is that this point is developers love building software. They love taking the next hype, the new technologies like Java 8, Java 9, and something else. But what I noticed is that developers are not falling in love with security that much. The first thing what they really hate, is for example, management bullshit, as I call it sometimes, so that microcontrolling stuff that project managers tend to do. But what comes next is most of the time stuff like security. So developers have some problems regarding that. So if you just look what a developer has to implement in his daily work and to deal with, so you have Java 8, you have DevOps, cloud, single page applications like Angular or reactive JavaScript, a lot of testing, being agile, microservices, NoSQL, big data, all that type buzzwords the developer has to deal with day by day. So what about security? So in an agile project, the developer is some kind of cross-functional, as we name it. So he has to deal with all that functionality. But unfortunately, most of the time, security is not in that cross-functional bunch of stuff. So why is that? Does anybody of you have an idea why this could be? I myself have some ideas why this could be. So this is my talk then about to perhaps improve that a bit. So developers always tell me, I'm not a security expert, I cannot really do that stuff. And what comes next is that our frameworks, our APIs, all that things that developers have to deal day by day are not secure by default. There was a talk by Jim Manico, I think, this year. He also talked about making the APIs secure by default. And that's a big thing that is missing currently. So this is my session about building secure cloud native application, because in Spring platform, there is a great effort in Spring Security now being actually secure by default. And I just want to show in a short live demo. Hopefully it works. So you can see that. So that's the starting point of a Spring developer these days. Start.spring.io. There is some Spring guy always telling that this is the second most important page for him after Google. If he's bored or something else, just call start.spring.io and build a new application. So using that one is quite easy. You just have to tell if it's a Maven project or a Gradle project, for example. And then you just specify if you want a web application. So just by typing, you can select what you need to build. So in our case, we want a secure application. So you can select security or even cloud security, then you all get that OAuth stuff already. And what you mainly get if you download this one is a zip file containing the finished project start. So you have an application that you can run from scratch. So I already prepared that stuff. So I had downloaded that zip file and extracted it already. So if all goes wrong. So we have our application here. So that's the application already that is generated automatically by that initializing page. And that application is secure by default already. I just have to add some snippets. These are required that we can see on the main page some string that we actually can see that the application is displaying a real value. For that, I have to implement a short snippet of code. So now we should. So I can start it right away now, that application. So if my IntelliJ is friendly today, you see it's starting. And one snippet is important now in that console, which is the default security password. So in the out-of-the-box default configuration, you get a generated password at each application start already out of the box. So you have a user called user, and you have that password to log in, actually. So if I switch to localhost 8080, you already get what is called basic authentication out of the box. And you can type in that user together with that. With that password. And then here we are, hello AppSec 2016. So now the next step would be you would argue that a generated password on each application start is really a bad thing. It's quite complicated.
but there's also some help. So you can easily set it to some secure password called secret, for example. And then restart that stuff. So now we should able to just log in with user secret. So again, here we are. So as you have seen, we have quickly built a secure application in just about 5 minutes or six, I think. I did not stop the time. But what you already have here now, is that you already have, by default, all that recommended as security headers by default. So the strict transport security, which only is, of course, sensible if you use SSL, but the X content type options are on by default, the X frame options are on by default. The XSS protection is on by default. So that's all you get out of the box in just 5 minutes. So let's return. So that was the first live coding demo. Unfortunately, it did work. So next would be a quite short introduction. Yes, you have a question? You mean form login or something? Yes, yes. So the question was if there was some additional authentication. So I have a detail on a slide later on. But yes, there is also support for form authentication as well. So you don't have to use basic authentication. So cloud native, because I'm talking about secure cloud native applications, first I have a quick introduction, what is cloud native? So cloud native is not just about technology, as you can see. So that's the most important thing, at least. So you have your Docker containers or your cloud containers to actually scaling applications in the cloud. So that's the base thing that you need. But much more important is the culture behind that cloud native applications. So you have to move from that silo thing between developers and the operations. So developers just hand over some application stuff. Here are my application stuff. And operations tells me, oh, we can deploy it in 3 months because we have to check if it's stable, if it has no vulnerabilities inside. We have to get an external penetration tester first and all that stuff. That would not work that way with building cloud native application, which we want to deploy fast, almost several times a day. And this is done with the continuous delivery thing. You want to deploy it really fast so you get time to market really quick. And what is doing that is the architecture that is implementing it. We've called microservices. There is another model just describing the maturity of a cloud-native application, how good it is actually, the cloud-native application. So it begins with level 0, if it's at least a bit cloud-ready. So it should, for example, have a self-containing artifact that you can deploy with all the dependencies inside, with some, for example, embedded Tomcat container, all that stuff. The next would be the cloud-friendliness of the application. So it should be at least scalable horizontally, not vertically. So you should have several instances very easily for your application. Level 2 would be then the resilient stuff, so that the application would self-repair if it breaks. So in former days, we already tried to implement that stable application that never will break, but if we all, how we all realize that it's not really possible. So we turned it the other way around and tried to build application that can react on failures. So with isolation, for example, or circuit breaker stuff, all the things that are important in the cloud. And the highest level of all is then the microservice architecture and AP design first, for example. You can read in more detail of about all that stuff in the 12-factor app. There are 12 factors that define a really cloud-native application. So you can deep dive further into that at that page. So what we are moving now is from the monolith of application. So this is an ideal build picture of a monolith application. But what you get from moving forward in your application, you will get sometimes a ball of mud, as we call it. And because of that, we are moving currently to microservice architectures. So we have smaller pieces of applications that can be built by just one team, actually. So 4 to 5 people can just build one application. The second advantage is that you can build language agnostic applications. So one team can build it in Java, the next team can build it in C Sharp or in Python or again Java. And they can communicate with each other by some lightweight protocol like REST APIs or messaging. So they are loosely coupled. And if one process, for example, breaks, then the other process still works. So if this one would break, then the whole application is broken. And additionally, you can now scale the different processes, the single processes, instead of trying to scale that big application. If we talk about microservices, then we go back to the technology. On Java side, most of the time, you find a direct connection between microservices and Spring Boot. So Spring Boot is really that what we saw in the demo some minutes ago, is to start over a project being cloud native. So the Spring Boot application already includes all the 12 factors that I mentioned already to really being a cloud native application. So it has some auto configuration inside. It had already an embedded servlet container inside, so you don't need anymore to deploy it manually to a WebSphere, to a Tomcat, or stuff like that. So you build jar files, not WAR files anymore, and it also includes production-ready features like monitoring stuff, health indicators, and stuff like that. So, because we are at a security conference, so I will switch over to what is a secure cloud-native application. So, I talked about our continuous delivery, which we are doing in the DevOps community. Unfortunately, here again, we are not doing it securely until now. If you look down here, we're doing, for example, Scrum as agile framework. We're doing our sprints with continuous deployments all the time. They can also happen in between the sprint by every commit, for example. So lots of deployments, but the pattern in our current project is really until now that we have that one penetration tests in that lots of deployment stuff over time. But the attacker doesn't care about how often we do that penetration testing. So the attacker sprints in here, or here, or here. In every deployment, we are potentially unsafe. So it's not sufficient to do that penetration testing at just one point of time, just before going to production with our deployment. So the attacker has a 24/7 time schedule. To deal with that, So we have to include the security in the whole DevOps process. So it's not sufficient to do it at the end here, but we have to integrate it in every step of our development process. So beginning with the vision of our product, we have to have an idea what could be security restrictions here. So at that soon stage, we already have to define it. Then we have the product backlog with all the requirements. We have to do evil user stories, for example. Then we have the central point, our sprint, actually developing that software with testing and all that stuff inside. Then we have the releasable increment, which should be secure. And that is deployed then by the operations support team. Even they have to deal with, for example, third-party libraries, which can be unsecure as well. So today's session is mainly dealing with that point of time. So if we talk about secure cloud-native application, then Spring security steps in additionally to the Spring Boot stuff. So what about Spring security? Spring security, as I mentioned already, is now really a secure by default configurable framework. Of course, we have support for authentication, as I already mentioned, not only basic authentication, but also form login. You have lots of authorization support, not only on the UI level, but also on the method level and also on the database level. So not only one level. If one level is broken, we have the next level of authorization. And we have secure password encoding, and we have a great testing support. So what is on by secure by default? The authentication is on by default for all endpoints. So if you don't change anything, all the endpoints are secured by the authentication by default already. What else do we have? You have session fixation protection by default on. So it's not possible to steal the session ID that you get before logging in when the user actually has authenticated, because he gets a new session ID all the time if after authentication. So that's on by default as well. Session cookie is secure in HTTP only by default. So you never can get it by JavaScript when you follow the secure by default conventions. See, cross-site request forgery attack protection is also on by default. Security, Spring Security can handle all that CSRF tokens out of the box. If you use Angular, for example, you only have to name how the token is transmitted. And you have the security response headers on by default. So on by default are not really a security header, but if you have sensitive contents, that is not quite good to caching them, for example. So cache is also disabled by default. The X content type options are on, X frame options are on, XSS protection is on. And if you switch to SSL, also the HTTP strict transport security is on, all by default. You have to switch it off explicitly. So you have to do a lot of things to turn it actually off, so it's on by default. When it comes to secure password encoding, so that's also a big problem sometimes that developers make it wrong. So there's a quite easy interface, so you cannot get it wrong. You have only an encoding function to encode a clear text password with that algorithm to an encrypted password. When you have, on the opposite side, you have a matches operation, which you give your raw password, which is given by the user, and your encoded password, which is that encrypted one. And internally, it just encrypts again that raw password and checks it against the encrypted one. So you never get that decrypted password, for example. And there are also safe implementations already in Spring Security, so no MD5 stuff or base64 encoding stuff, which is all developers are doing wrong all the time. So even in the documentation, there's no words anymore about MD5 or all that unsecure stuff. So you, out of the box, you can use these password encoders, and the Spring community always takes a look, are there still secure algorithms? I think the time is a bit, so I will over switch that demo. I will come to the next. Yes? What? The input validation, that is still has to be done by your application. So Spring Security only brings in that security header, for example, preventing cross-site scripting. And you can, what I forgot, additionally to that on by default headers, you can also configure the content security policy, for example, in Spring Security quite easy. So you can just switch off inline JavaScript completely, for example. But Spring Security out of the box does not have protection against, for example, Angular 2 clients, so that they can validate or escape correctly. So the input validation has still to be done by your application using all that OWASP encoder, for example, if the framework does it not for you. What we are doing in our project, we use, for example, the bean validation provided by Java IE standard. So we do some regex, for example, so that we only allow these regex characters that are coming in. So no blacklist, but only whitelist input validation. So I talked about cloud native applications. So if it comes to the cloud architectures, so that simple authentication mechanism doesn't work anymore. So we don't want anymore that shared credential stuff that we had in the past. So passwords here, the password here with our user data, that does not work anymore with our current API designs we have in the cloud. And we have lots of clients, different clients now. We have a single page application. We have server side UIs. We have the mobile apps applications. So lots of roles that have to work together with authentication and authorization. So OAuth2, for example, steps in at that case, which replaces that handling that we're giving all that OAuth tokens to the backends, and the clients have to deal with that tokens. So on OAuth, we have the three different roles, actually. We have the OAuth client that acts on behalf of a resource owner, for example, me as a person just wanting to access some resource. And we have the authorization server that actually deals with that whole credential stuff. And we have in the back the resource server actually serving that resource we want to access. So I cannot deep that further into the OAuth section. We already had a session on OpenID Connect, which is basically above that OAuth flows that we all know. So even that in Spring Boot and Spring Security is quite easy to implement. So just to implement a tweetable OAuth application, you have to use two additional annotations on your application, and you get a full authorization server for OAuth. Out of the box, you can just ask him for access tokens out of the box. So these tokens are not the secure ones, just basic access tokens, not Java web tokens. If you want to use Java web tokens, that's also possible with that Spring Boot, Spring Security stuff. But you have to configure some snippets additionally then. But it also supports all that signing automatically with your private public key stuff, which not much more effort. So the last point I want to show, so now that we have a secure cloud native application, we can do further security to our application. So we can implement the runtime application security protection. So that not only the intrusion detection detects some attacker after some while, he has attacked and doing wrong things, and we detect it one day later, for example. Now we want to have that in real time. And you can do that with a tool called AppSecEU, also an OWASP open source tool, which is founded by Jim Melton on GitHub. And that has already also an integration into Spring Security. So if Spring Security has some unknown behavior, then it also integrates already with that AppSecEU and talks to that AppSecEU. So what you define actually are some detection points for your application. If it detects, for example, lots of wrong login attempts or lots of big data uploads that a user is trying, then you have a policy for the AppSecEU. The policy is trying to define what is really an attack or what is not considered as an attack by AppSecEU. Then the events come in for login events. If a user tries to log in several times with wrong password, for example, or does try to do some cross-site scripting inputs several times in some input field, then you get that event to AppSecEU. The AppSecEU just analyzes if that could be an attack based on that policies here. If he thinks that is an attack, then he creates some response back to the application. He considers based on that policy, and the cloud native application then implements some response for that. So for example, a logout of a user for several minutes or shutdown of a part of an application if it's attacked or shut down the whole application or just notify an administrator about that event. What you have in the back is you have an AppSecEU UI, a dashboard that shows the administrator all the stuff that is going on in the application. So I can just show some. So here we have that dashboard actually. So you have authentication events, input validation events, or request events. What else do you have? Unfortunately, the browser is a bit too. So what you get is an activity log, which for the events are coming in. So for example, if you have input validations, authentication events, so all the time events coming in and it analyzes if this could be an attack. In that sample, we have just the REST client generating all that attacks for us so that we can actually see here what is going on. Yeah, that's also possible because you have a database behind it, so you can also export all that stuff. But it's great to see it in real time, what is really going on for an administrator. So you just can see what is going on in real time. So if there's some problem and my application can really react on all that stuff. So you can implement reactions to all that attack recognition sent by the AppSecEU app. No, just the dashboard UI needs a database, so to store all that events. What you actually need is that AppSecEU server application you have to talk to, and optionally you can have the dashboard just showing all that events. So to wrap up the session, we talked about building cloud native applications securely. That also begins already in that Spring IO platform. So that's the basis for all the Spring applications currently. So that platform actually deals about the whole dependency management you have to use in Spring and dealing with all the third-party dependencies already. When you use Hibernate, for example, or any other framework that you are using with Spring together, this platform also defines which dependencies work with other dependency versions. And what it also does for security reasons, the company Pivotal that is behind the Spring community always publishes updates to that platform with all the dependency management if they detect security issues in third-party libraries. So if you're updating that regularly, you get all that updates for all that security leaks in other third-party dependencies as well, out of the box. Then we had Spring Boot, Spring Security we talked about, Spring Cloud is also a library for all that cloud-native stuff like cloud circuit breaker, service discovery, and all that stuff. And then you had that OAuth library above that. And on that side, we have that real-time application security protection. So as we have seen, hopefully the developer gets a bit more fun using Secure by Default security framework as of now. So as you've seen, we have lots of Secure by Default conventions inside. All the protection with security headers already, cross-site request forgery protection. What is still needed are a bit better Secure by Default developer APIs. One good example is currently Angular 2, for example, or Angular 1. They have built in a strong cross-site scripting defense out of the box in their framework. So Angular 2 already has this built in as well now with release candidate 3, I think. They've built the same protection inside that, all with cross-site request forgery. And they even have updated their documentation, so they really name unsafe APIs now. So by name and also in the documentation, which is great from my perspective, so that a developer just can recognize, oh, I cannot call this, this is unsafe. So hopefully that way we get better and better and make more fun for the developers for security. Okay, thank you. This is my GitHub. You can look into all the samples, which I could not show in totally today in that GitHub repository. And these are the documentation. If you want to know more about Cloud Native Java, then look into that. And I think I don't have to mention the book by Jim on Ironclad Java. Okay, so have we time for questions? Already answered all questions. So just try it yourself.
Thank you again.
Yeah.